installment of the United States Hispanic Chamber of Commerce's Presidential Candidate Q&A series. At this time, please silence your cell phones and refrain from taking pictures during the program. Now, please welcome to the stage Javier Palomares, President and CEO of the USHCC, and Hillary Clinton, former United States Secretary of State.
You're going to go to the far seat. I gotta say, all due respect, man. But seriously, thank you, Secretary, for joining us this morning. Again, I want to welcome you to my home state of Texas. I know, again, that you have a very busy schedule, so I want to commend you, frankly, for making the time to speak to the USHCC and the Hispanic community. We appreciate that very much. Now, I know that later today you'll be receiving an endorsement from a fellow Tejano. In fact, he's a San Antonio native. And I think that, and most people think, that he would be a great pick for vice president. I'm just saying. So not to put you on the spot, man, but what do you think about considering Julian Castro as vice president?
Well, I think really highly of him, and I am thrilled to have his endorsement today. Both he and his brother, the congressman, are just among the best young leaders in America,
absolutely,
regardless of category or the fact that they come from San Antonio. So I am going to really look hard at him for anything, because that's how good he is, and he deserves the accolades he's receiving. You know, but you're on my short list too, Javier.
And see, that's how stuff gets started right there.
And it is his birthday. This one's birthday today. So, see, I'm already doing my research.
Well, then you'll know that I'm ancient, man. So,
hardly.
Less than 48 hours ago, I had really the pleasure of attending the Democratic debate. And the whole world has been talking about it since. But I'd love to hear how you feel you did in the debate.
Well, you know what I liked most about the debate the other night is that there are differences among all of us on the Democratic stage, but those differences pale in comparison with the Republicans. You could see those two long Republican debates, and when they weren't insulting each other or insulting some other person or group of people, they were not talking about the issues that are confronting our families or that our nation faces. So I was proud to be on that stage with Democrats who are focused on dealing with everything from how we're going to raise incomes, how we're going to make the wealthy pay their fair share, how we're going to make college affordable, how we're going to get the cost of prescription drugs down, all of the issues that we were talking about. So I came out of it, you know, very pleased that the country had a chance to hear an alternative to the prejudice and paranoia that we are hearing from the other side, led by their flamboyant front runner. But I would be quick to add that if you listen to all of them, they all, to a degree or so, sound like him. They just don't have the pizzazz and the hair, but they're making a lot of the same unfortunate points in their candidacies.
Well, since it's the last day of Hispanic Heritage Month, let's begin by talking a bit about the Hispanic electorate. Now, in 2012, it's no secret that President Obama garnered about 72% of the Hispanic vote. And never before has the Hispanic electorate played such a pivotal role in electing an American president. And I believe that never again will an American president be elected without openly courting America's Hispanic vote. Consider that today in America, every 30 seconds, a Latino turns 18 and becomes an eligible voter. That's approximately 58,000 brand new voters every single month. And man, that will be the case for the next 21 years in a row. So with all of that said, what is your plan to continue to engage the Hispanic community? And I think specifically, I'd like to hear how you think your four fights, as you call them, will help Hispanic Americans, as you say, get ahead and stay ahead?
Well, I came to Texas 43 years ago to register voters, predominantly Hispanic voters. I worked in South Texas. I lived in San Antonio for 3 months, and I made friends of a lifetime. And so for me, this is personal. I have been in people's homes. I have worked with my friends from the community across the country on issues that we care deeply about. So I will continue to do what I've always done, which is to recognize the manifold contributions that the Hispanic community has already given to the United States, and knowing that with this extraordinary opportunity we have with, as you say, Javier, young Hispanics coming of age, taking their place in society and in the economy, of course, I would hope that they, like every young person in our country, would assume the most fundamental right of a democracy, and that is to vote. Obviously, I would hope they would vote for me, but I want them to vote, period. I want them to stand up and be counted, their votes and their voices. So what I started all those years ago in South Texas is pretty much what I am going to continue, and that is having the kind of conversations and listening to what the priorities of the Hispanic community across America are. And in every area of this campaign where I have laid out my policies, I believe that they would certainly support Hispanic families, the creation of more good jobs, rising wages, improved education, dealing with health care and the costs that are still too high for too many families. So I know how important it is that my policies and my priorities reflect the real needs of the American people and not some ideology that is unconnected to the lives people are leading today. In particular, and I know we're going to get to this, because the chamber is so focused on business development, that's been a particular concern of mine, both as a senator and as Secretary of State. As a senator, I worked with a lot of small and medium-sized businesses in New York and looked for ways to, you know, really support them in their growth. And since Hispanic-started, Hispanic-owned businesses are the fastest growing in America, and the fact, which I love to say, is Hispanic women are starting more businesses than any other group at a faster rate, then I am very focused on small business. My father was a small businessman, a very small business, but it provided a good living for our family. And I want to be the small business president, and I want to pay particular attention to minority-owned and women-owned small businesses to try to knock down barriers, create more paths forward for you to be successful. That will disproportionately help the Hispanic community because you are disproportionately creating more small businesses. And I want to see more success from the ground up and have more businesses, you know, join the front ranks, join organizations like this. In fact, somebody told me this morning, the very first Hispanic Chamber of Commerce was started right here in San Antonio, right?
And they're in the house.
Right?
They're in the house.
And so this is not a new phenomenon, but I want to be a president who helps take it to a whole new level and create much more in terms of business success than we've ever seen before.
Well, I have to tell you, Madam Secretary, this is now, you are the sixth candidate that we speak to. We've spoken to everybody from Ted Cruz to Bernie Sanders to Jeb Bush to John Kasich, and the list goes on. You are the first one to say that you will be America's small business president, and I appreciate that very, very much. God bless you. So let's talk about immigration, ma'am. As you know, Hispanics are not monolithic. In fact, some of our own polls with Hispanic business owners show that jobs, the economy, trade, national security, and energy independence are all important to our community. And we'll get to those in a bit. But on the issue of immigration specifically, our association views immigration reform as an economic imperative. And I know that you've taken a very progressive stance on immigration. Additionally, other candidates, including Martin O'Malley, who's been part of the Q&A series, pledged during his Q&A to expand President Obama's executive actions and pass comprehensive immigration reform within the first 100 days of his presidency. So my question is, what concrete commitments are you able to make on reforming America's broken immigration system?
Well, first, let me say that I really agree with the point you were making in your question, and I want to repeat it publicly, because I think so much of this debate about immigration that is coming from the Republicans is really misguided and misinformed. And it's time somebody said what the facts are. Immigration is good for America. Immigration built our country. Immigration has provided a pathway to opportunity. I dare say that the vast majority of Americans, regardless of political affiliation, have an immigrant and a parent, a grandparent, or a great-grandparent like I do. So I think it's important that we start from a different premise than what we're hearing too much of from the Republican candidates. Secondly, the evidence is clear. Comprehensive immigration reform, where we bring people out of the shadows, will be good for our economy. It will raise wages, and it will create even more opportunities. Now, when people of good faith, as opposed to just being partisan, say, wait a minute, we're worried that it might really depress wages and take jobs away from folks, that's not how it works. If we can get people who are hardworking people who are here, many of whom, as you know so well, have been here for decades, have raised their children, have contributed to their community, if we can get people out of the shadows, then our labor market will be more efficient and the undocumented workers will not be exploited, which is what does drive costs, wages down. We will also see a big increase in the amount of money going into our tax base, including the Social Security system, which is an important issue because we have to maintain its solvency. Right now, undocumented workers contribute about $12 billion a year into a system that they will never be able to take advantage of. Comprehensive immigration reform will increase that to at least $20 billion and go up from there. So I know it's hard in the back and forth of a campaign to kind of get the facts out, but that's why organizations like yours and leaders like those sitting here in the audience, the more you can do to push back on some of these assumptions that are really wrong-headed and mean-spirited, the better chance we'll have to do what I know must be done to get comprehensive immigration reform. Now, clearly, I would start working on that from the very beginning of my presidency. I will also, though, defend President Obama's executive actions, and I will begin the process of setting up a streamlined approach so that more individuals can apply for deferred action. Because right now, we don't have a single place in our government for people with strong arguments, worthy cases, to be able to go. And I will not be breaking up families under deportation. I want us to get toward comprehensive immigration reform, and I don't think the way to do that now is to undermine the family structure and undermine the productivity of the people who are in our economy. So I'll be working hard immediately as president to go after those objectives.
Courageous approach, ma'am. Now on to trade. A big issue that the USHCC has worked on has been the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Considering that 98% of U.S. businesses that actually do export are typically small businesses, we think that access to more markets abroad is a good thing for the entrepreneurs that we represent. In fact, every $1 billion in U.S. exports supports about 5,000 American jobs, jobs that pay better and that last longer. Our association is particularly elated to know that for the first time in any trade agreement that we know of, TPP actually includes a chapter specifically dedicated to helping small and minority-owned businesses. Now, you supported, I believe, the idea and the deal about 45 times while secretary. But last week, you said the following about TPP, and I quote, "As of today, I am not in favor of what I have learned about TPP," and you go on to say, "and I don't believe it's going to meet the high bar I have set." So the question is, ma'am, on trade, in what specific ways do you believe President Obama has failed to meet the high bar that you have set?
Well, let me start by saying when I was Secretary of State back in 2012, I did say that I hoped this deal would be the gold standard. And you're right, it was an idea that I thought was certainly worthy of support. Now that the details have been made public, like a week or so ago, I don't think it meets it. And there are two sides to the argument that I am making. The first is, one of the biggest problems that we have faced as a nation for businesses of all sizes has been currency manipulation, and particularly from Asian countries that have played their currencies in a way to raise the costs of our exports and to favor their imports into our market. And there was a lot of debate about this, as you might remember, in the Congress. And I, among others, hoped that there would be enforceable currency manipulation provisions. There are not. That doesn't mean that there couldn't be. And I think that it is still something that the Congress and the administration should be working on. But we can have a very aggressive, positive trade agenda that can be undercut to our disadvantage by changes in how currency is valued by central banks and governments abroad. China has been a particular leader, unfortunately, in that regard, but not the only nation. I also think that much of what we need to be doing to support our companies and our workers requires the kinds of changes that President Obama has advocated, that I too support, that the Republicans have blocked. You know, trade is a great additional opportunity so long as our economy is strong and people feel like their hard work is paying off. And right now, that's not how so many Americans feel, because after the 2008 crash, 9 million Americans lost their jobs, 5 million lost their homes. And this is the most shocking statistic. $13 trillion in family wealth was destroyed. So although I give President Obama enormous credit for avoiding a Great Depression and digging us out of this ditch that we were in, we're not yet running. We're standing. We're not running. I want us to be running, and I want people to recover not only their jobs, but the dream of home ownership and begin to rebuild their wealth. And I don't want the Republicans to claim, wrongly in my opinion, that the answer to building a strong economy at home is only a big trade deal. I want to see them raise the minimum wage. I want to see them do more to support the Small Business Administration. I want to see them do more on job training, making community college free so that workers can improve their skills, and a long list of others. But I will say this, Javier, when I was Secretary of State, I worked with others in the administration. We increased exports by 50%. Mm-hmm. And we focused on small and medium-sized businesses that often don't know how to get into the global marketplace. So I would redouble those efforts. And I would do a lot more as the American government to support any business that thought it had a product to sell in the market. I want to just tell you a quick story. When I was Senator from New York, I spent a lot of time trying to help small and medium-sized businesses grow. And if you've been to New York, it's not just New York City. You know, it's a big state going all the way to Canada, lots of poor communities, lots of people who were just barely getting by. But a lot of them were producing goods and services that they couldn't get into the global marketplace because nobody had ever said, hey, how can we help you? So my office helped them set up websites. My office helped them open doors to government procurement. We had a huge meeting with all the government agencies, particularly DOD, about how small businesses could get in the door. I want to do more of that. And my favorite example is I had an annual farm day, because people don't even know that New York has farms. And so I would bring all of these farm products, and we'd have a big display, and people would sample them. And there's a little tiny company that makes great ice cream. And it was positioned next to one of the wine companies that makes their wine in New York. And one, you know, and people would come and they'd stay and they'd have a good time. And so later on, somebody was taking the wine and pouring it onto the ice cream and saying, this is really good. And pretty soon there was a big line, people taking the wine and pouring it on the ice cream. And they created a new product, wine ice cream, that they now export with our help to half a dozen countries. So one size doesn't fit all. We need to go at this issue of growing businesses and growing exports from many, many different angles, and that's what I will do.
Certainly your track record on small business and the support you've given it historically speaks for itself. Thank you for that. So, but just to make sure that I understand, it's not TPP per se, but rather the loopholes that still exist within TPP that allow for currency manipulation that you're having an issue.
Yes, that and the pharmaceutical provisions, which I think do more to protect big pharma than they do patients and consumers, and the fact that the other half of the equation, like how do we build up folks at home to be successful so that they can compete in the global marketplace, is just unaddressed by the Republican Congress. So, you know, I don't know when this trade deal will get to the Congress because there's a lot of loops it still has to go through. But I am talking publicly about it because I do think the Republicans will support it. But I would like to see them do more to help American workers to be more competitive, to take advantage of whatever trade opportunities are out there.
So you're evolving on the issue?
No, I'm against it now, but we'll see whether there is any kind of significant changes. I mean, look, if the Congress tomorrow adopted my entire, you know, work and wage agenda, I'd be pretty excited about that. But I think that'll have to wait till I'm actually there as president.
Fair enough, man. On to small business, let's talk a little bit about Hispanic businesses specifically. Hispanic-owned businesses now total over 4.1 million in this country, and they are at the forefront of American economic growth. We're starting new ventures at a rate of 3 to 1 when compared to the national average. And to your point, it's Hispanic-owned businesses that are owned by Latinas who are at the very point tip of the proverbial spear. Our businesses collectively contribute over $661 billion to the economy every year. My question is, as president, how would you continue to spur the growth of all American businesses, but specifically for this audience, specifically Hispanic-owned businesses?
Well, I've got a number of ideas about this. One of my longtime friends and advisors, Jose Villarreal, is over there leaning against the door. And he was part of my effort in the State Department to build up the connections between Hispanic businesses in our country and marketing and partnering opportunities in Latin America. You know, it was part of my diaspora strategy because I think we should be doing more specifically to help Hispanic businesses find more markets with the growing middle class in Latin America. And that takes a concerted effort. It doesn't happen by accident, to go back to what I was saying, opening more doors, holding more, you know, trade meetings and seminars and conferences so that businesses can make connections with potential opportunities with partnerships and franchises and other ways of building businesses here. So that's something I started in the State Department, and it was the germ of an idea that I think can go much further. I would also try to clear away a lot of the confusion that exists. You know, I hear from Hispanic business owners that it is harder for you to figure out how to navigate the federal bureaucracy, to know where to go to get information that is really actionable information, what kind of websites are needed, what kind of online applications could be available as opposed to having to jump through, you know, a bunch of hoops. So I want to work with a task force, work with the chamber, Javier, to get very practical suggestions about how do we make it easier for you to start businesses, to find credit for businesses, to apply to the SBA, to find partners like community development funds, to be able to, you know, understand everything that's out there and to provide more mentoring. You know, the biggest concern that I hear often from small businesses You have a great idea. You got the hard work. You're willing to put in the sweat equity, but you might not have the business experience to be able to translate all of that into an ongoing concern. How do we do more to help, you know, small businesses share expenses for necessary goods and services? For example, you know, lots of times a small business can't on its own afford, you know, the tax work that is necessary to get up and going. To work through all of the questions that you face at the local level, the state level, let alone the federal level, why don't we have like a pod of services that will be a lot cheaper for individual businesses to tap into? Because you won't be paying for it all by yourself. A tax group that we would help support that would work with a myriad of businesses. That's just one idea. To get the costs down, to get the information more accessible and understandable, and to provide some of the mentoring that will enable more good ideas to become successful businesses.
At the USHCC, we're very focused on empowering women and ensuring that they have the necessary resources, networks, experiences, and training to continue to lead in terms of small business growth. And as a consequence, we've looked at gender equality in a much broader context. And I want to talk to you about something that's been problematic, and I've asked this of all of the candidates because I think it's critically important. In terms of gender equality, I want to specifically focus on women's wages. Domestically, women's wages in the United States continue to stubbornly lag behind men's. While doing the exact same job, a woman generally earns about 70 cents on the dollar when compared to men. And Hispanic women are earning closer to 60 cents on the dollar. So my question is actually twofold. Why do you think that exists, ma'am? And as president, what would you do to address this disparity once and for all?
Well, this is one of the major, yes, let's give a round of applause for the question. This is one of the major planks in my economic platform. We cannot grow the economy and get wages rising unless we end the unequal pay that women in the workplace are still suffering under. And I say this not just as a woman who's worked on behalf of women's rights here at home and around the world. I say it as somebody who has studied this closely. And I understand that one of the biggest potential opportunities we face to getting incomes up, to growing the economy, is to ending this wage inequality. Now, why does it exist and why does it persist? Well, some of it, let's be honest, is just good old-fashioned discrimination. You know, a lot of women in the workforce are just taken advantage of by their employers. And then it is perpetuated because the laws don't crack down on employers who intimidate their workers into not sharing information about their wages and threatening retaliation if they do. How do you know you're not being paid equally if you can't get information about what your work colleagues are being paid for doing the same job? The most famous case of this was the Lilly Ledbetter case, a woman who worked her way up from the factory floor to become one of the four men on the assembly lines. She was the only woman. She didn't know for years that although she was doing exactly the same job and had more experience than some of her colleagues, she was being paid less. I had a young man in New Hampshire come up to me just last week and say, I want to tell you why I'm supporting you. And I said, well, thank you. Well, why? He said, well, I'll tell you. He said, my first job when I was 17 years old was working as a cashier in the same store where my mother worked. My mother, he said, had worked there for 4 years as a cashier. He said, I started that job. I was pretty proud. It was my first formal job. At the end of the pay period, I came home with my check, and I proudly showed my mother, and she quickly realized I was being paid $1 more an hour than she was after having been there for 4 years. Wow. Now, that is unfortunately too common a story still today. And too many women who are either helping to support their families or the sole support of their families are afraid to ask questions and raise this issue. That's why we need to crack down on employers from the federal level through the Department of Labor, why we need to incentivize state and local governments to do the same, and why we need to change the laws so that if you do ask the fella standing next to you, what do you make an hour? You're not going to get fired for it. How can you negotiate or request or demand more pay if you don't even know you're being mistreated and you're being discriminated against? This is a problem across the world. This is not just an American problem. But when I was Secretary of State, I made the case that every country could raise their gross domestic product if they got more women into the workforce and they paid them fairly. So this is a big deal for me, and I'm delighted that you are asking about it, because I think too many people view it as a woman's issue as opposed to what it truly is. It's an economic growth issue, and it will be great for the American economy when we finally close that gap.
In fact, it would add $851 billion to the American economy if we just brought women's wages up to the... So on to race relations. First, I want to begin by commending you for your longstanding track record on promoting civil rights. Like you, the USHCC believes in the fair treatment and inclusion of all communities. We don't believe that doing well and doing right necessarily have to be exclusive of each other. But with that said, racial discrimination, sadly, in the United States, has gained the attention of the press and public recently, especially in regards to what appears to be police brutality that is all too frequent. It seems like racial discrimination stubbornly persists in the country to this very day. So my question is, why do you think that is, Madam Secretary? And as president, how would you address the racial tensions that still exist in America?
Well, I think we all have to agree that we face real problems of systemic racism and injustice. That's been painfully made public over the last several years because of these incidents that have resulted in the deaths of young people, predominantly African American. And I salute the Black Lives Movement for raising this issue to the high priority that it now is, so that we're finally talking amongst ourselves, mayors, members of Congress, governors, police chiefs, everybody is having to figure out what do we need to do to tackle these inequities within the criminal justice system. Really harsh, inflammatory language coming from the Republican candidates about Hispanics has just added to the ongoing problem we face that it's okay still in America to be condemning groups of people with this kind of rhetoric and opening the door for those who then feel somehow free to not only speak in pejorative terms, but even to act in a way that is prejudiced and hurtful. So we do have to make changes in policy, but we also have to make changes in attitudes. And we have to call people out when they engage in the kind of language that too often gives cover to those who want to act in a biased way. I don't think this is solved overnight, but I think anyone in a position of leadership in the public or the private or the not-for-profit or the faith communities in our country does have a responsibility to call people out when they say, Mexican immigrants or drug dealers and rapists. Somebody needs to say, basta. Stop it. Enough. Don't do that. And so I feel, you know, I feel passionately about this. The first time I ever had the opportunity to be around Mexican migrants was when I was about 11 or 12 years old. And my church asked girls my age to babysit the little children while the older children went with their parents to the fields on Saturday. It's hard to remember. I grew up in Chicago. Well, a lot of fields in those days. And the migrants would, the workers would come from Mexico through Texas, through the Middle West, up to Chicago, ending up in Michigan to pick the crops. And I remember going out to this encampment where the workers lived and looking after the small children. And at the end of a long day, there was an old ramshackle bus that was coming down the road, and it stopped at the end of the dirt road that led to the encampment. And when those little children saw that bus, they started to jump up and down because they knew their mothers and their fathers and their aunts and their uncles and their big brothers and sisters were coming home. And as soon as the door to the bus opened, those little children just started running down that road. And the parents, as tired as they were bending over and scooping them up. And I remember saying to my mother when she picked me up, you know, they're just like we are. They, you know, they're just families like we are. And I remember running to my father's arms when I was a little kid when he would come home from work. Somehow we have lost the connective tissue that is built by common experience, where we see one another for the human beings that we are. We put ourselves in each other's shoes. You know, one of my dear friends is the daughter of a migrant farm laborer from California who was able to get an education, get a law degree. But she remembers what it was like, and it wasn't that long ago. So for me, this is, yes, about changing policies, calling people out on hateful rhetoric, but it's also about rebuilding bonds between us, whether we are living in big cities or small towns, where we see each other again, where we respect each other's dignity again. And as president, I will do my best to model that, to encourage that, and to support that in every way that I can.
Well, ma'am. I'm afraid that we are out of time, but I don't want to miss the opportunity to tell you that you happen to be sitting right next to an ex-migrant farm worker, the son of Mexican immigrants, the youngest of 10, English as a second language kid, former high school dropout, and I am immensely proud to be seated right here with you. Bienvenido a Texas. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me thank Secretary Hillary Clinton.
Bless you.
Thank you all.
Okay, man. I think we're off this way. Man.
Hey, thank you.
Hi. Oh, excuse me. You guys do your work.
Thank you.
I'm not shaking up anymore.